Well, welcome everyone. Thank you so much for coming again to our Tuesday night Healthy Living Lecture Series. This is our second to last one. Can you believe that? The summer is, oh my goodness, I cannot believe it. So tonight, I'm so excited to hear about cleaning green, DIY products you can use to clean your home safely, and I'm assuming a little more cost effectively. So it is my pleasure to introduce you to Marsha Munsell. She has worked for the Cooperative Extension for over 20 years, teaching nutrition, food safety, food preservation, and cooking. She's expanded her classes to include home health as well. She has had a keen interest in reducing the number of chemicals in her own life and is excited to present ideas for reducing their impact on the lives of others. While attending training in Montana last year, the model for this class came up, and Marsha is pleased to bring it to Fairbanks. So please help me welcome Marsha Munsell.
I was instructed to use the mic. Can everybody hear me if I just project? Okay, good. I'm used to that, actually. All right, so thank you for coming to learn about cleaning green. I can see everybody out there, even though the lights are dim. So just for a moment, if anybody has any comments about why they might be interested in cleaning green, could you raise your hand and just spout out a comment or two? And don't be shy.
Cheaper,
okay.
I've had chemical poisoning before.
Ah.
It's quite serious, so I
want to
go as green as I can.
Okay. Okay, so you're one that's experienced it.
Yes.
Okay. Everyone else is here because the series has been a successful series.
I just want to use fewer chemicals in my house.
Fewer chemicals in the house. Yeah, Holly.
Sewer might work better if you're
absolutely, yes.
That's
a really good reason to think about using less chemicals in your home. It's because all those chemicals go down the drains, and we will mention that briefly. And if you want to talk more about it, we could do that too. But we'll see where it all takes us. So we're going to go with this PowerPoint because it's really good for me to stay directed and focused. But if you guys have questions when we are going through this, by all means, get my attention and we can have a discussion too, okay? I don't claim to know all the answers, but I certainly will make attempts, and I could always look for answers because I have great resources at my fingertips with Cooperative Extension. So moving on, why do we do care? I wrote, why do we care? But we should care. I'll put it that way. People spend an average of 90% of their time indoors. Studies conducted by the Environmental Protection Agency show levels of several common organic pollutants to be 2 to 5 times higher inside the home than outside. Many of these pollutants come from the volatile organic compounds, or VOCs, you might see that in some places, released from household cleaning products. Indoor pollutants can be reduced by limiting the number of chemicals used indoors. By following 3 basic guidelines, you can improve your indoor environment, save money, and help conserve natural resources. So we're going to take a look at some of those things that we can do. So the first tip is to keep it simple. Simplify cleaning and reduce VOCs by using fewer products. It'd be interesting for you to go open up your cabinets and just see how many products you have and how old some of them might be. Things do break down over time also as far as chemicals go. So if you're looking at products that are in the 90s, or the 80s, or even the early 2000s, you might consider, you know, disposing them of them in a mindful way because they could be hazardous products, and moving on with different products. Okay, so preventative cleaning is one of those. I know our lives are really busy, and things happen. I have an incontinent dachshund. And it's really annoying sometimes when you're just headed out the door and she decides that she doesn't want to go outside. And so you have to stop and clean things up. But when you wipe spills up immediately, it does make a difference on how hard it is to clean later on. Protect your surfaces from spills. So if you put down, like on your stove, if you've got the old-fashioned stove, you know, with the units, or with the, like a regular electrical stove, not one of the flat tops, or a propane stove, you know, you could put little protective things down there. And that helps you wipe things up, okay? Use a doormat at the entryway. How many of you have doormats?
Yay!
Yeah, because they're very effective at catching some of the dirt before it goes in the house. How many of you love to clean your hallways? Yeah, right? Especially, I see a few gardeners in here. I know what my entryway looks like sometimes. It's like, whoa, what happened here? So removing your shoes at the door, that's a real Alaskan custom, and I think it's really an awesome custom. People who visit us from outside, they look at it at first and they kind of go, wow, we have to take our shoes off? And I just smile and say yes. because it's a hassle to them to, you know, bend down and undo their shoes and all of that. But it does help with the whole cleaning process. Try not to pour grease down your drain. And you might think, I don't pour grease down my drain. That would be really silly. But how many times do you just kind of put in a pan that's kind of greasy and the water starts floating with grease and then you just pull the plug? So taking a towel and actually wiping some of that grease out of the pan before you wash it would eliminate some of the grease going down. If you have had to use any kind of plumbing aid because of the pipes being plugged up a little bit, you might rethink about your habits and the things that might be going down the drain to plug those.
It seems like if I have that issue, I squirt a bunch of soap right away, put really hot water and chase it. But they also have an awesome, you see the thing at Home Depot? It has a little handle and it's a strip of plastic.
Yeah, it's like a little.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it just goes into the drain.
And cleans it out without putting caustic, well, you said it. I couldn't. So what she said. without pushing. And like Holly brought up earlier, and I haven't planted Holly. I just know Holly from, you know, another life. But when you use those really caustic chemicals, if you have a septic system, that septic system does suffer. I'm here to tell you that I've lived with a septic system for over 30 years and have not had to pump it yet. So I figure I've been pretty successful at keeping it viable and keeping it working. I have some interesting practices that some people think are kind of weird to accomplish that, but it works. And if you want to talk to me about that later, you're welcome to. Yeah, so putting oil in old jars and then putting it in the garbage works just fine. Yeah.
How often should you pump the septic tank if you're on a, you know, you're not on a city, septic field, a draining field.
Yeah, leach field.
How often do you recommend it?
It depends on what I call viable your leach field is. If it's full of good bacteria and it's breaking everything down, When you start getting backflow and backup, definitely. But I honestly don't know the suggested number of years that you should check it. That would be good for me to check into. But I don't know the answer to that. Yeah, sorry. I'll have to go talk to a plumber. All right, let's move on here. So the tip number two would be to make your own cleaning products. And again, keep it simple. You don't have to have these big exotic recipes. The products that I have on the table can pretty much cover most things, laundry and house cleaning. So, you really don't need a lot of products to get multiple jobs done. And we'll talk about how to accomplish cleaning with what I've got here on the table in a bit too. Okay, so the environment. Homemade cleaners are less toxic, and choosing commercial products that are less toxic is also important too. So if you don't have time to make your own products, then choosing products that have been shown, and there are agencies, there are two agencies, Green Seal is one of them, and my brain just turned off for the name of the other one, but I have it at the end, I think. There are third-party agencies that take a look at different products and let you know if they're, viable, or if they're not viable, but if they're good for the environment, okay? If they're okay to use and not impact the environment in a very negative way. The Environmental Working Group, you might hear me mention that name a few times during this presentation. Going to their website is like diving down into Alice's Wonderland. They have all kinds of information on not only the chemicals in cleaning products, but in cosmetics and different products around your home. And they rate them, and they don't accept money. To get, like, a company cannot say, oh, let me donate $1 bazillion so I can get number one on the list. They don't do that. They blind rate the products. And so I trust, they're one of the places that I trust to get decent information about rating different products for use and the amount of chemicals or the amount of like the volatile organic compounds that might affect you or not. It is not a bad idea to invest in good equipment. So my idea of investing in good equipment is to get microfiber cloths. They might cost a little bit more, but they work really well. A lot of people say, ooh, I don't like how they feel on my hands, because if you have rough hands, all their little fibers kind of catch and it makes it feel but there are different grades of microfiber, so you can get really expensive ones, or you can go to an auto parts store and get a package, which is what I do. These are basic packaged microfiber cloths. They work really, really well. These are glass, and you don't need spray with these. I'll demonstrate in a little bit when we turn the lights. When we turn the lights back up. So it doesn't mean that you need all these really fancy cleaning equipment things. Look for something that works for you that is simple. If you have a hard time wringing out a mop, look for something that you don't have to wring out. There are mops with microfiber pads, not the kind that you throw away, but they have pads that you can actually throw in the washer and wash and reuse, or just rinse out in the sink and reuse, and have these little squirt things on them, so they're awesome. but look around for things that might be useful to you. So be aware that some companies claim to have natural ingredients, and natural in this day and age actually can mean almost anything. And it depends on who
naturally came out of my lab. So just be aware that you should check, get a second opinion, you know, about something that you might be interested in. So this website, www.ewg.org/guides/cleaners, that is the website to go to get. It's the Environmental Working Group. That's where you go get an idea of what products, if you're into buying products, would be better for the environment. And for you personally, also. Okay. So, I think I totally forgot where I am in on my list here. Some cleaning supplies can contain chemical endocrine disruptors. And many chemicals can cause asthma and allergies. So endocrine disruptors are chemicals that may interfere with the body's endocrine system or hormone system and produce adverse developmental, reproductive, neurological, and immune effects. And that's why I feel so passionate about this new information that's coming out. There are people that are actually in the midst of researching. The research is not complete by any means. But there's a feeling out there of we should be careful because, you know, our bodies are being affected. A wide range of substances, both natural and man-made, are thought to cause endocrine disruption, including pharmaceuticals, dioxin, and dioxin-like compounds. That's one of the easy words to remember. Some of the other ones, they're even hard to pronounce. Polychlorinated biphenyls, or BPA, probably heard of BPA, and BPS was made as a way to get away from BPA, but they're finding, maybe BPS isn't that great either. So those are in plastics.
Those are on the inside of cans, like you get your organic canned beans.
They can be. They are not necessarily, but they can be, depending on the manufacturer. Endocrine disruptors may be found in many everyday products, including plastic bottles, metal food cans, detergents, flame retardants, as in kids' PJs, food, toys, cosmetics, what are you putting on your face, and pesticides. So the National Institute of Environmental Health Sciences support studies to determine whether exposure to endocrine disruptors may result in human health effects, including lowered fertility and an increased incidence of endometriosis and some cancers. Research shows that endocrine disruptors may pose the greatest risk during prenatal and early postnatal development when organ and neural systems are forming. So, the National Institute of Environmental Health Sciences is one of those big consortiums that is working on some of the research right now in this realm. Okay? So you might look for things coming out in the future from some of the research that they're supporting at this time. So what do endocrine disruptors do other than make me wrap my tongue around my teeth? They mimic or partly mimic naturally occurring hormones in your own system. They mimic estrogens and androgens, which is the male hormone, and thyroid hormones, potentially producing overstimulation of your thyroid. They bind to a receptor within a cell and block the endogenous hormone from binding. The normal signal then fails to occur and the body fails to respond properly. So examples of chemicals that block hormones are anti-estrogens and anti-androgens. I Has anybody here heard of the anti-estrogens? Look for that. It will be coming out in news stories in the future. And they are chemicals that they're simply chemicals that mimic male and the female hormones and keep your regular hormones from working in a proper way.
Are they a good thing then?
No. They are not. They are not at all.
Are they in cleaning products? Or?
It can be. Yeah.
If people do certain things during their reproductive years, later on, is it going to hurt people that are way past the age of menopause or something?
Probably not as much, because most of these studies are being conducted, and we don't know. I should say we don't know yet. Most of the studies right now are being conducted on in utero, babies in the womb and young children and pregnant women. They've been conducting studies on pregnant women, just measuring the number of chemicals in their bloodstreams. And some scientists are becoming quite amazed at the levels of chemicals that are showing up within the bloodstream of different people. So depending on where you live, it's higher in the general population than in other places, and depending on your lifestyle. So I find that kind of work.
Those numbers really huge, like the number of chemicals, like in the hundreds?
Oh, there are thousands of chemicals. They're only looking at
when they actually tested a person, they came up with hundreds of chemicals.
Yeah. Kind of scary. You know, we're all worried about mercury and fish. And we should be. But, you know, we're also breathing and ingesting ourselves many chemicals that may be quite harmful also. Yeah.
So when we're talking about these disruptors, this is hypersensitive.
Yes. Yes. That is thought to be the general outcome. And there was an interesting look at the waters of the Bay Area that actually drew a lot of interest, because they were looking at all the chemicals in the Bay Area. They were quite interested in the mutations of the fish in the Bay Area and the frogs. The frogs are turning up with odd-looking bodies. And so that sort of that study or that research drew more interest in, well, if it's in the Bay Area and the waters there, and can we process those chemicals out, or are we ingesting them? So they're looking at that now too. You know, do the water purification systems really get rid of all these chemicals? Some of them not. you know, and it depends on the water system. At least as far as I've read in some of the studies that I've read. And I did bring, if you are interested, I did bring some of the research that I've been reading, and you're welcome to take a look at this. Or if you're really interested, you can put your email on the back and I can just send you this list, you know, if you want to follow up on it yourself. Okay, so. Oh, whoops. I guess I should have pushed the button, huh? So they are found in everyday products. Another thing that you should look for on labels is glycol ethers. Avoid products with ingredients such as 2-butylethylenol, or EGBE, and methoxydiglycol. DEGME. So when you're reading labels and you have these mind-boggling chemical names, it is hard to really figure out which ones are okay and which ones are not. But again, letting a third party research that and looking into their research is quite helpful. But those two in particular can also damage fertility or unborn children and can cause asthma and allergies. And they are found in cleaning products, paint products, brake fluid, and cosmetics.
Kind of
an amazing combination of things, huh? It makes me, my dad said, I used to kid me about putting axle grease on my face, and now I'm beginning to wonder how close he was, to that comment. He had other comments too, but I won't go into all of them. So be aware that natural ingredients too can trigger reactions in some people. Fragrances are a big, broad spectrum of chemicals. There's a great big influx of use of essential oils, and they're thought to be benign, and they're thought to be awesome and wonderful, and they can be, and they have been very beneficial for many people. But I would also look at them as possible causes of reactions in your own body. Not everybody is the same. No one's made the same. And that's why it's really difficult to have just a broad statement like, don't eat this or do eat this, because, some people can smoke and drink until they're 99, just fine. And then just say, okay, I'm checking out, and be done. And other people, can struggle in their 50s. So everybody's very different. Examples of oils that have been shown to cause reactions in people are citrus oil extracts, rose flower oils, and lavender. And lavender is in wide use, both the synthetic, because it makes things smell so good and it's supposed to be calming and wonderful, and the natural. But just know that research that's being done right now in Europe is finding that these oils in particular are causing reactions in some people. So if you find that those wonderful essential oils are not turning out to be so wonderful, it just might be that you need to look at something else. Another oil that may not cause that reaction in you, or another product altogether. So again, you can check out the Environmental Working Group's Guide to Healthy Cleaning, and they actually address some of the fragrances also, and you can find out a little bit more about that. So, let's see, avoiding chemical buildup. Allergies are an increasingly serious health issue for millions of Americans, and especially children. Especially those of you that have been in the schools for any length of time. Are you finding that when you walk into the schools these days, it's a little different than it was maybe even 10 years ago? There weren't the little signs on the doors, this is a peanut-free classroom. Don't bring this or that or the other. There weren't the same number of kids with inhalers in their desks. Something is happening. The Federal Centers for Disease Control and Prevention estimates that the number of American children and teenagers reported to suffer skin allergies more than quadrupled from 2 million reported cases between 1999 and 2001 to nearly 9 million between 2008 and 2010. Another 12.6 million children and teens were estimated to suffer from respiratory allergies in 2008 to 10, and the CDC said almost triple the estimate of 4.4 million in 1999 to 2001. So there's a huge increase, huge. So we do want to be careful about the chemicals building up in our bodies and the chemicals that are building up in our homes. Here in Fairbanks, Alaska, we close our homes up to a certain degree for many months of the year. If you have, a kind of system that exchanges air, that's actually a really optimal thing to do so that you can actually have clean air coming into your home as often as possible. But for many homes, especially older homes that may not have a system like that, there is a buildup of different chemicals in your homes. And again, the chemicals are building up in our soils and our water supply through our septic systems, through our just dumping, through, personal lack of personal responsibility, let me say that, and just not being mindful of what you're doing with different chemicals. How do you get rid of them? How do you store them? What can you do? So, down to the meat of the program that you really came here for. I don't know if you came for all that other background hoofrah, but I think it's important to give you an idea of why I'm so passionate, and hopefully you'll catch a little of that fire and maybe think a little bit in the future. So, ingredients to make your own cleaning products, they're pretty simple. White vinegar. Pretty cheap, less than $2 a bottle. Baking soda, a little over $1 a box. Lemon juice. I ran off and left my Castile soap. Washing soda.
Marsha, is the lemon juice as that kind of lemon juice just as effective as it would be if you squeezed fresh lemons?
Yes, because it's the acid. That's a real good example. What she said.
What did she say?
Dr. Bronner's. Dr. Bronner's.
What did she say?
Dr. Bronner's soap is a it's a name brand of a Castile soap.
Ooh.
And it's a soap that biodegrades in the environment. One of the joyful things that I was able to do in other summers. Has been to work with a wilderness group, and that's one of the things we require, that no one bring any other kind of soap except a Castile soap, because we're in a pristine area, and you don't want stuff out in a pristine area. But that does break down. It's a plant-based surfactant-type soap. And it seems really expensive, but you also, it's a concentrate. So you, when you're putting it in a dispenser for your sink, you never put it in full strength. Usually 1/3 soap to 2/3 water. And so it actually is a little more cost effective than the price tag looks. Okay. Washing soda is different than baking soda. Do not use washing soda for baking soda in any of your cooking. This is more caustic. The chemistry has been changed by heat, and that changing of the chemistry does make it more effective as a cleaner as far as washing your clothes. But don't ingest this. Do not put it in your mouth.
Find that in the laundry aisle?
Find it in the laundry aisle. Yep, and the reason I brought this, I know we're not supposed to embrace certain brand names, but sometimes you just visually, and there aren't that many washing sodas. There's not that much competition. There's also not much competition in the realm of borax. And so borax is another laundry booster type thing. And you can also use borax in cleaning up really as a paste. You can combine the two and make a paste and clean up really nasty, greasy things, like out in the shop. You do have to wash them down, because they you have to rinse them, and stuff like that. But they are effective as degreasers also.
Can you pour it down the drain, or do you have to take it outside and toss it in the grass?
This actually, from what I understand, this is less toxic in your drains. Okay? And if you, for baking soda, it's definitely less toxic. You can use this as a cleaner, much like you would cleanser, because it has the same or similar consistency. So it has that slightly abrasive action. And this you can also dump down your drain. Some people, to unclog a drain if they don't have that wonderful tool, put down a little bit of baking soda, a little bit of vinegar, hot water, and let it bubble all up with the vinegar, and it kind of breaks up some of the debris in a drain. Yes?
Given this list, when do you wear latex gloves or
do? Oh, that's a really good question. The washing soda, if you were doing a lot of cleaning, you might want to wear, because this is a little more caustic. It's still, if you're using it occasionally, or I should say this, I put washing soda, I mean, I use this, so this is a really nice little container because you can get big amounts or you can But
what is that?
Washing. It's
you're
a spice. Yeah, it's a spice container. Oh, sorry, I'm working
what's,
in the dark.
What's inside? Yeah.
Washing soda.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, you can also put baking soda in a container like this. You can just sprinkle it. But maybe this. Generally, anything else wouldn't require gloves. They are not that caustic on your hands. Vinegar. If you have a cut, lemon juice or vinegar will stain that cut for sure, but it's not going to affect the skin, it won't affect the skin like some cleaners will.
Can you drink or eat white vinegar or use it just as you would cider vinegar?
I wouldn't recommend it.
You would not?
No, I wouldn't.
Okay.
Because the benefits have been stripped. So what's the point? I use this for cleaning.
Yeah.
And I use a real apple cider vinegar with a mother in it for the benefits of apple cider vinegar.
Yeah, okay.
That's just personally, take that FYI.
Good
That's
answer.
Just world according to Marsha. You can find out your own stuff on that. So vinegar is, a lot of people say, oh my goodness, it really stinks. And I might be getting ahead of myself. So club soda is another, it's a quick kind of bubble up. If you've spilled something on a carpet, you might put club soda on it immediately. And the carbonation in the club soda, because it doesn't have sugar and it doesn't have anything else in it, it's just essentially sparkling water. Sparkling water, same thing. That carbonation helps bubble up some of those stains. So you might give that a try as a first action to a spill on a carpet. Or get rid of your carpets and just buy it. Just go to hardwood floors or laminated floors. So white vinegar is our all-star, all-purpose cleaner. You can use it for just about anything. If I had only a really, really small cabin with about room for two things, vinegar would be one of them under my sink. Okay? My spray bottle says vinegar. it cuts soap scum. Someone was mentioning, or we were talking earlier about showers. And so spraying it down, don't let it dry because it's drying and the soap scum is still there. But spray it on and then let it sit for just a little bit and then go in and use some elbow grease. Vinegar really helps, and it might, depending on how thick your soap scum is, it might take a few applications. But you might be surprised at how, and especially if you use a microfiber cloth, it really does help a lot. Pardon me?
Do you dilute the vinegar?
You can, depending on the job. So you can dilute it anywhere from one part vinegar to four parts water, down to higher concentrations depending on the job that you have at hand. My general solution is about half and half, you know, just because I'm spraying down the stove and wiping up the cabinet, and wiping up the cabinet really doesn't need that much, but.
Do you know what the ratio is in order to kill germs in vinegar?
A 4-to-1 is antibacterial, yes.
But that's, you could pour straight vinegar like on your soap scum in your bathroom, and it's not going to hide from the stuff around?
No, it shouldn't. Yeah. Yes, as long, yes, thank you. As long as it's not marble or some kinds of tile or some granite counters. And I had a conversation about someone about granite. They said, oh, granite's like impervious. But I went back because I thought, oh, maybe I just remembered, which is quite possible. And actually, I read again, there are some components of granite that can be affected. So you might get a little bit of pitting, you know, if you let vinegar just stand on a natural stone type surface, okay? Because it is very acidic.
What I've seen it do is just take the shine completely away of its reacting.
Yeah. So then put some oil. No. And it can break down mineral deposits. So for the same reason that it can break down mineral deposits, that's how it affects that stone, okay? Because they're made of minerals. It cuts the grease on dishes and crystal. If you have crystal that you want to just shine, you can do that 4 parts water to 1 part vinegar and shine it with a microfiber cloth, then oh my goodness, it's turns. Any of you have crystal chandelier? Not my life, but yes.
Will this recipe actually take care of the smoke scum that you get on your windshield when it rains?
Oh, through the smoke. That is a really good idea. I've used it stronger than that. For the scum on my windshield when it was really smoky outside, I think I ended up almost using straight. I used the half and half, and that got quite a bit. And then I have the patience of a gnat, and so I went to straight vinegar and used the straight vinegar. Because I also live at the end of 2.5 miles of dirt road, and so not only was there smoke and grime, there was dust. Yes, ma'am.
What do you recommend then, like for granite countertops?
Water?
Just water.
Yeah, water is amazing. It is amazing what you can clean with water, especially if you are on top of it, shall we say. And a microfiber cloth. yeah, it is amazing. Hot water, if you've got a really nasty, something that's caked on or whatever, you know, like when my granddaughter helps me bake. and then we go play for a minute, and then I come back and go, oh, dear. A little hot water, just poured right on it and scrub it up. It's amazing what water does, actually. A lot of people don't give water the chance that they should. Sometimes between my bathroom mirrors, I don't even spray all this other stuff on. When I get out of the shower and the mirrors are all misty, I just take a towel and wipe them down, and they're clean and beautiful. No fuss, no muss, you know? And it takes some of the steam off.
Boiling water will take out blueberry stains.
Yes, it does. So one of the classic ways to deal with stains, not all stains, but quite a few, is to stretch the fabric over a bowl, and you can, you know, put stays around it, like a big rubber band or whatever, and then boil water and pour it from about 2 to 2.5 feet above the bowl, and you're thinking, But if the penetration or the force of the penetration and the heat of the water actually help take out the stain. So you've had pretty good luck with your various stains.
Yeah. That's boiling water.
Boiling water. Yep. Nothing added.
Yeah. So for your offer this cleaner recipe where it calls for the vegetable oil based liquid soap, is that the best?
Yes.
Okay. Marsha, you probably know this, but in a dishwasher, many of them have those little places where you put the ingredient to keep the water spots off, and you can just put white vinegar in that and it works really good. And I used to have harder water and I would put my glasses all in the dishwasher and then just throw a cup of vinegar in the bottom of the dishwasher and run a cycle, and they came out spotless. There's no stuff on it. It's like miracle stuff.
A testimonial, and I did not plant that testimonial.
I love vinegar.
What about blood stains?
Oh, blood stains are difficult. Get to them right away with cold water. Try to dilute the stain as much as possible. And then Phil's naphtha is to rub in and get it nice and worked in while it's still somewhat fresh. It is the best way to go about it. If it's an old stain, take my scrub brush too. I got up too early. Take a scrub brush and work the Fels Napa in, and then take an actual cleaning brush or a scrub brush and just a stiff bristled brush and just scrub it. And that helps a lot too.
Cold water.
Yep, and cold water. Yep.
Would sandpaper work?
No, that would probably rough up the fabric a little much. The bristles, depending on the fabric, I should back up because knitted fabrics, you wouldn't really want to use those stiff bristles, but the sandpaper would probably affect the finish on the fabric.
So that Fels Naphtha, is that something that I'm like the laundry so fine?
It is, and I brought this because it hides. I don't know how many people I say, oh, just go to the laundry aisle, and they come back and say, ugh. It's usually on the top shelf, and it's hiding usually kind of near the borax and the washing soda. But you can make your own laundry soap out of Fels Napa or borax and washing soda. I make these little, they're called laundry bombs, and they actually work. You know? I have to put more in when my dear one comes home with his diesel-soaked, clay-soaked pants, because they're difficult. But
do you need the portions of all that grated up?
There might be I can't remember if I included that recipe. If I did not, look through real quick, and if you're interested, I'll write my email up here, and I'll email you that recipe. I've got like a whole folder of
make
your own products. Okay, great. If you're interested, just email me before I forget. Fairly decent at following up on emails. It may not be exactly the same day.
Does the laundry soap work in a high efficiency?
Yes. Because it doesn't oversuds. Yeah. So white vinegar, even though it has its own smell, it neutralizes pet odors. And the vinegar smell actually goes away quicker than you think. If you've never used vinegar, you're probably one of those that say, but it's amazing at how quick it really does dissipate when you're spraying it and using it as a cleaner. It also deters bugs on skin. I read this really cute thing about how in the 1800s, women would put pickle juice on their skin, and it would make their skin soft, and it
a gentleman kissed your hand and smelled the pickle juice, then it meant that you were taking care of yourself. And then maybe you would be the lady that he should become endeared to. Anyway, different time, different. It also cleans floors, mirrors, and toilets. Okay? So one of the things, before we go to baking soda, I brought this. This is my vinegar. White vinegar. At my house, we have oranges and limes and lemons, you know, with some regularity. And so I just take those peels, throw them in a jar, dump the vinegar in, let it sit for a little while, a week to 2 weeks, and you can come up later and smell the vinegar. It's not, you know, like no vinegar smell, but it is definitely a little more pleasant than straight up white vinegar.
Those are skins, like orange skins? Or?
Orange peels, yes, orange peels, yep.
What kind of white vinegar?
Just regular white vinegar. Oh, nice question, Ellen, because I discovered that there are some vinegars now that are white vinegars that are coming out at 4.5% rather than the good old 5%. They're adding water to bring the percentage down. So look on the label and make sure you get your 5% so you can get your money's worth. Do your own diluting. All right, so baking soda, of course, is a really good deodorizer. It's a great abrasive cleaner. It does clean grout. You can also use a brush, like a nail brush. If you get really anal, you can use a toothbrush. If you put your kids on timeout and give them a toothbrush, no. Not that I've ever done that. It does polish silver, if you have silver that you want to polish. It removes burnt food on dishes. So how many of you have burned a pan and then you, while the pan's still hot, you put water in it and it goes, and then you put baking soda in there and it goes, and then you come back in about 10 minutes and wash it and it's clean. Yes! Yeah, I did that just 2 nights ago, unfortunately.
And you ruined the pan.
No, I didn't. I had a stainless steel pot, and I thought, so I made the mistake putting the broccoli on, just steaming it, and then got involved with my grandkids, and all of a sudden, the smell was overwhelming. And I did not ruin my pan. I did not ruin my pan. I put warm water in it. So I'm, okay, thank you for sending me down that trail. So it does make a difference depending on the integrity of your pot. If you put cold water in a really hot pan, that's not beneficial. If you put hot water in the hot pan, you know, that's a lot more beneficial. All right, so we're going to run out of time if I don't keep going down the road here. It also removes heel marks on your floors. Lemon juice is...
We don't wear our shoes and size. We don't have any.
I know, right? Good point, Beth. Lemon juice is a great disinfectant. Vinegar also disinfects, but lemon juice is great on cutting boards. You can soak paper towels or a microfiber cloth with lemon juice and just lay it on your cutting board and completely disinfect it without submerging it and warping the board. So it's great in that way. It removes stains off Formica, and actually, so if you get after the stain pretty readily, we processed a whole bunch of blueberries, and I just squirted it down with vinegar and wiped it up. Pretty amazing. With salt, lemon juice polishes brass and copper, and as I said before, bleaches your wooden breadboards, and it helps remove rust stains. Also cleans chrome. Yes, sir?
Either lemon juice or vinegar, would they be effective against mold and mildew?
Yes. They will help kill the mold and mildew because they're really acidic. but you still have to use soap and water to actually get rid of the residue. And I can't help myself. A lot of people use chlorine to get rid of mold and mildew, and basically it kills the mold and mildew, but the mold and mildew is still there. It's dead and it won't grow anymore, but it's still there. And that dead mold and mildew can affect your asthma or your allergies, just like the live mold and mildew. So CDC is now saying, get out your scrub brush, get out your soap and water, and clean it. Clean it up. And they're actually moving away from, in fact, you won't find chlorine on their website as in the same way that it used to be.
What about ammonia?
Ammonia can be useful in some cleaning instances, for sure. You don't want to mix it with any other kind of product because of the reactions that it can have, especially chlorine.
Oh, yeah.
This deadly gas.
But does it have the same kind of problems?
Problems as well. As far as, you know, I honestly haven't read as much. It's listed in one of the safe product guides, but I haven't actually read as much about the why and the how, so I honestly can't address that background. Another rabbit hole for me to dive into. Or you, and you can tell me. So club soda cleans up, it cleans up coffee and tea, soda pop, Kool-Aid, red wine. Get it on there immediately. Works best, you know, if those stains are fresh. It will lift old stains, but it takes repeated application to do that. So persistent.
Kool-Aid. That's a strong day.
It is. I know. It's a complete dye. Mm-hmm. The carbonation helps bubble the stain to the surface, and then take that brush and kind of scrub it up. So rust, hydrogen peroxide, works pretty effectively in toilet bowls. My good buddy Virginia Damron and I have done a program similar to this together, and we experiment before we start spouting our stuff. And she was like, I like a clean toilet, Marsha. I mean, I like a clean toilet. I'm like, okay. She tried hydrogen peroxide. She is, if anybody knows her, ask her what hydrogen peroxide does in toilet. She will give you a whole story about hydrogen peroxide. On chrome, aluminum foil can help clean the rust on your chrome. Cream of tartar and lemon juice, if you have a rust buildup on your countertops, that can help get rid of that rust. If you have rusty utensils, a little bit of onion juice can get rid of the rust on those utensils. And in clothing, lemon juice and sunshine, or Fennel's Napa soap, soak it in hot water. And if that doesn't work, you might try making a paste of the cream of tartar and working that in with your scrub brush. So if you have a little bucket with a scrub brush and your cloths and a little spray bottle of vinegar, good to go, you know, for jobs all around the house. If you have wood floors, you can clean them with tea and make them look nice and wonderful. If you have scratches from dogs that have their nails way too long, you can actually fill those in with a crayon. That's one of Roxy Dinsdale's tricks. For ceramic tile, you can make a mixture of water, borax, and ammonia. There's your ammonia for that. For vinyl, warm water and borax. Has anybody read the warning labels on toothpaste? I'm going to challenge you to go home and read the warning label on your toothpaste. You might be amazed. Get a magnifying glass or your readers.
has a warning label on it. Yes. And so for many years, I personally have been making a mixture of salt and baking soda. Tastes like.
Yeah.
Sometimes I put a little bit of peppermint oil in it. But I was advised to do that many years ago by, you know, a naturopath that I was going to. And it's cheap. And, you know, when I go get my teeth cleaned, you know, that my hygienist says, oh, wow, you don't have as many barnacles. So I think it's quite effective personally, but I, you know, I would offer it to you as an alternative to some toothpaste that might have those warning labels on them.
What's your proportion of baking soda?
Baking soda, two. Wait a minute. Baking soda, 3 parts. Salt, 1 part. And you can just do straight baking soda if you're trying to keep your salt sodium levels down.
So I can just regular table salt?
Yes.
And that's been abrasive, so I suppose if you have problems with your enamel, just leave that one out so that you're not rubbing it so hard.
Yeah, and it dissolves pretty readily. It actually is, and I honestly can't remember how it's beneficial. For some people's gums, it can be beneficial. So, you know, you might talk to your doc or whatever about that to see if it works for you.
That also makes a good gargle with water, baking soda, and salt.
Yeah,
very good. Gargle.
Especially if you have a raspy throat.
So, if you swallow it while you're brushing your teeth,
it's not going to hurt. Thus, the warning label. Mm-hmm. How many kids do you know that absolutely spit all their toothpaste out in the sink? I'll read the warning label.
tastes so good.
I know it does. And there are toothpastes that don't require warning labels, so just be aware of that. Do a little research and figure out, you know, if you have younger people in your house or if you prefer to do a toothpaste, there are options out there. I would say that.
Do you put that toothpaste soda and salt thing up on the up on there again?
So I take a tablespoon and I have this little jar that I always use. And I put 1 tablespoon salt and 3 tablespoons of baking soda, and I shake it all up, put it in my medicine cabinet, and just sprinkle it on my toothbrush. Pretty easy. And if I feel really extravagant, I can just stir in, you know, some kind of peppermint oil or wintergreen oil or something with a chopstick.
My grandmother used to use salt and soda and nothing else on her teeth. She was 87 when she died. She didn't have any cavities or fillings or anything else. Her teeth were perfect at 87.
Oh, that's awesome. How much sugar did she eat? Probably not very much.
Sugar.
How much sugar?
Well, she liked candy.
All righty then. That says something for the baking soda and the salt.
Yeah.
The other thing about salt is you know, our bodies are somewhat saline. I mean, you know, when you put drops in your eyes, they are saline drops. So, you know, salt gets a bad rap, but your body, it does match some of what your body's fluids are, if you don't overdo. Okay, so there are other, if you want your house to not smell of that cabbage or that ferment that happens to be going on in the pantry, you can use cat litter stationed around your house as a way to absorb that smell. Charcoal is another great absorbent. Baking soda, coffee actually absorbs odors. So for refrigerators and freezers, clay, charcoal, or the baking soda, that kind of
old mildewy smell. Like if you get a grandma, you inherit grandma's dresser and you open the drawers and you go, ooh.
Yeah.
You know, just soak a piece, get a plate. Yeah, get a plate. Put a little bit of vinegar on a piece of white bread, put it in there, and let it sit for a day or two, and then take it up and throw it away, and it will help get rid of that smell. You can make your own air fresheners with soda, a little bit of ammonia, some kind of wonderful scent that works with your body, and water. And you can spray that around rather than the aerosols that have propellants and different chemicals.
By coffee, do you mean the grounds?
Coffee grounds, yeah. So a stain removal kit might be your clothes brush, little sponges, paper towels, cotton balls, you know, whatever it takes to put things away. Your plastic spray bottle full of vinegar usually. So your solvents are baking soda, ammonia, vinegar. You can use petroleum jelly as a solvent on particularly nasty things like bubblegum or really sticky things like resins. And then Fell's Napa is a great thing to have in your kit. Pumice stones, look for them in the cleaning aisle. They're great. Just put your gloves on. Or you can find them on a little wand now, too, where you don't even have to get your hands down in the water. And they clean up stains. You know, if you do the brown down, yellow mellow thing, your toilet bowl gets a little stained after a while. And pumice stones are great for taking care of that buildup.
Doesn't take the ceramic off?
Nope, because the ceramic is harder. The kind of pumice stones that you use specifically for, you don't just go out and get any kind of lava rock.
Okay. I might do it.
Yeah, I know. That's what I'm saying. there's a particular pumice stone made for cleaning ceramics. And look for that. And it's not quite the same.
It's supposed to turn into a paste.
It does. It can take some of the shine, but when you're dealing with, then you use your hydrogen peroxide too.
Marsha, how much hydrogen peroxide?
About a cup.
One cup.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, 3 bottles.
Yeah, no, it's. We found that about a cup to a cup and a half, depending on the water level in your bowl or the stain in your bowl, and depending on the stain too. Like Virginia keeps hers really clean, so she was thrilled because it. Sparkle, whereas I have to apply my, because we do the, you know, yellow mellow, that thing. And so when I'm really cleaning, doing a deep clean on my tea bowl, then it takes a couple of applications for me. And you have to let it sit for about 15, 20 minutes up to an hour before you can get in there and scrub. And perfect. Yeah, because vinegar works too. Yeah. Okay, so in your investigations, you might want to become acquainted with Green Seal or Ecologo. They are nonprofit companies that research and certify products that are biodegradable and environmentally friendly. You can visit their websites to get lists of different products. And to verify whether the products that you're using are safe to use. I'll leave that up there for just a little bit. We ready? So, these are websites that you can also investigate safe ingredients. The EPA has its own website with lists of products that are safer, especially as far as health So there's the EPA and Cooperative Extension and a couple of other government agencies that have come together recently in the past couple of years to bring forth this whole healthy homes education and idea. And so you can go to these websites to get more information about cleaning products that might be better for you if you have asthma or if you have allergies or just to always get sick for whatever reason. You know, if your immune system seems to be compromised.
Is that www2 or is it www.2?
It is www2. Ooh, I'm going to have to take a look at that. I don't know if my happy fingers just got way happy. Oh, that's a really good question.
Probably just coming up to it all.
Yeah, try, go ahead and write it down that way and then try it without the two and see what happens.
Okay.
Yeah. It's probably without the two.
Two is kind of near the W.
It's, yeah.
My little fingers got it.
Oh, I tell ya. Especially late at night. There is a Dirty Dozen. It's hard to find on the Environmental Working Group's website, but if you Google Dirty Dozen cleaning products, it's an old list, and it will give you a list of chemicals that you should look for that are not only in cleaning products, but other products that you should definitely be aware of, like the BPA and the dioxins, and it actually gives you a number of things.
They're saying that Clorox now is kind of...
Well, part of the reason for that is that people usually get overzealous, and chlorine gas is really not good for you, and especially if you're in a small enclosed area. And with all the other environmental factors that are in our lives today, and the many, the compromising of our immune systems, that, I mean, all of that factors into, you know, maybe being a little bit more careful about using chlorine bleach. Especially if you would never, what they're cautioning against right now, this handout does talk about chlorine bleach, and it talks about using chlorine bleach. It also says do not use it straight.
You know what?
Don't use it straight. Always dilute it. Always
Isn't it a base as opposed to an acid? And so, I mean,
it's
like you can't get it off your hands.
It is.
It's going into your skin and into your body.
Yeah, and it's more about the gas, too. Yeah.
I combined it one time with some stuff. It's really good.
Yeah. Hello? Yeah, I'll bet that was a little bit of a wake-up call. All right, so everything else fails.
Give me a call.
And if I'm in the office and answer the phone, I'll try to help you out. And if I'm not, you can leave a voicemail and I'll get back to you because that's what I do. You had a question. Now your hand is up. Done.
Your email is MK in your last name, is that right?
Yes.
Okay.
Wow. Yeah. So take a look at these, you know, later on, put them by in your bathroom for a little interesting reading. There are a number of recipes that you could try. And if you have questions about those recipes and why they work or if they work, you can give me a call.
Are there more of those available? I think you ran out here.
If I may have run out, but if you are interested in those, come and put your email right here, and I will email a whole set to you or send you a set if you want to just put your address.
There was one thing up here. I guess it's kind of a special problem. TV monitors and computer monitors are like magnets for everything in the air. What do you suggest for paying those? Just with water?
actually just the cloth.
Yes. Just the cloth.
Just the cloth.
This is for what? Cleaning windows or something?
For cleaning monitors. Yeah, because it actually is a really nice dust collector. And if you've got smudges, then you can spray a little bit of vinegar on the cloth and then wipe it down. You don't need much. Okay. Yeah, I'm completely sold on those cloths. I didn't used to be, but I changed my mind.
You know, there's another cloth real similar to that, and you can clean windows and glass. It takes off fingerprints and oil and everything without using any fluid at all. And you can reuse it and reuse it and reuse it, and then eventually wash it. It's amazing. It's super, super fine.
Yeah, that would be someone like this. This is the more expensive one.
You look even finer than that. I mean, you look at it and it's a silver color.
Oh, like polishing, the polishing with microfiber.
Cool.
One thing to thank you for mentioning washing. You don't want to just throw these in the washer. It is best to, because they collect, and so it is best to maybe put them in a little cloth bag to wash them, because they'll just stick. If you've got anything. And speaking of drying, instead of those dryer sheets, the chemicals in dryer sheets are horrible.
Really?
Yes, they're horrible. If you really need the smell, you know, you can create your own smell. But you can also take some yarn. Just make a ball and then felt it by putting it in the washer and then putting it in the dryer. I throw a couple of these in and it helps you release the static clean. It's just 100% wool. Nothing else will really felt. You know, my husband said, they're not coming undone.
And the dryer sheets that are, you know, that says fragrance free, like the Fountains, is the only company that makes the ones that are fragrance free and have no additive, no fragrance, no other additives to it, is that. Are those?
I honestly don't know the answer to that question either. I would look, that would be something that you might want to research and look at the product list. It's not, the fragrance is a big part of the chemical package, but there are other chemicals that
release to
make the clothes feel soft, to make the fabric anti-fling, and those chemicals also are some of the chemicals that can be endocrine disruptors. So they're generally thought to be not the best.
Yes, I have to share, because you had peppermint oil on your list. I learned that putting drops of peppermint oil into a spray bottle of water and you spray your ceilings and your windows, you will not have any cobwebs or spiders. They do not.
Oh, my goodness.
So peppermint oil and water after you clean it thoroughly. I sold my house.
Awesome. I didn't even know that. That's awesome. Thank you for sharing that.
What did she say?
You know, peppermint oil and water sprayed around your ceilings and stuff where spiders like to make their little cobwebs, and the spiders don't like it.
So you have to keep doing it like every month or so, but still, that's, I think.
Worth it? Cool. Yes.
Textured refrigerator.
I know, those are nasty, aren't they? Vinegar and cloth.
Did you speak to the two different strains of hydrogen peroxide?
I don't know about two different strains of hydrogen peroxide. I know that there's one hydrogen peroxide that's really, really strong. So I'm thinking of the regular brand that you could buy on the grocery shelves, not the one that you go to the North Pole Pharmaceutical and buy.
So the regular available off the retail shelf.
Yes, and that's the one I'm talking about. And I don't know the percentage of concentration between the two.
The one is 32 or something, they're really high.
Yeah, that's a lab.
Can't go in the fire.
Right, that's a lab product.
3% is the lab.
And you can actually brush your teeth with it. I mean, it's that.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. You can stand. It feels in your mouth. All right, well, if there aren't any more questions, or do you want to? I think we're finished.
Yes, thank you very much.
So I'm wondering if there's a support group for people who plan to give up Tide. I love the smell of Tide, and I'm willing to spend $20. Somebody close.
Yeah.
Have they come out with a Tide since? Because that's not going to miss. This was wonderful. Thank you so much. So next week is our last week. Maybe we'll be grieving that, too. It'll be a very grieving. But it'll be good. Catherine Messenger, she's a registered nurse at FMH, and she'll be talking about stopping the sugar coating of diabetes.
Okay.
So I visited with her about doing this lecture before, and so I think it'll be really, really informative. So thank you for coming. Have a good evening, and we'll see you next week.
The toothpaste. There used to be a product called Pepsodent tooth powder.
Oh, yeah.
And it was basically just what you described.
Yeah.
And of course, that's gone.
That,
well, I do too. You know, so. Anyway, it was interesting that you brought that up.
Yeah.
I had never seen this before. I think it's just that it's stronger than regular baking soda. I've been using a 7th generation soap.
Me too.
But
maybe this is all you need?
Oh, for washing. And for soaking stains out.
I was going to say I use the 7th generation for dishwashing. It's so, doesn't have that chlorine smell.
Oh, I use the 8th generation. That's better. Because it was stained
instead of it. All these, it'll take it out. So I'm just going to go buy this. Maybe this is way cheaper. And
that's what they're selling me in 7th generation.
Yeah. My mother used to use this all the time.
Oh,
Borax.
I read a thing once that said if you take this would be, well, you couldn't really take it, but it says just take your clothes that haven't even been washed, a bunch of t-shirts, and they put them in the rinse cycle and check the water that was coming out until there was no soap residue left in those t-shirts.
Oh,
18 rinses. And those were clean clothes coming out of what you were wearing. So the clothes we're wearing has all kinds of detergent residue.
Tide
is one of the strongest.
See, that's why if I use Tide, I'd be unscented.
If I use Tide, I get little rashes on my hips. My skin reacts to it, so it's just it's the only one.
Really,
it took me a long time to figure out why do I have these rashes all over.
Right, but it's but I would believe that because the smell, which I love, is so strong. So it would be.
I'm using one fifth of the amount that they say. See if there's still smell.
But you like the smell, and doesn't bother you.
I love the smell. And it doesn't, like, when clothes are drying in the house, it's like, oh, man.
It must mean all's well with the world.
Right.
Laundry's done.
Right.
We're on track for the week or something.
Yeah.
I have my bottle of vinegar.
I can't. Well, check out Method, because Method might be on the list of good. I mean, part of the reason that.
I don't know. I think I'll take the straight vinegar.
Really?
To
out what
the I know, right? It looked pretty nasty, didn't it?
This has actually been in here for a while. I should have brought the one that we put together just last week. It looks better.
Well, you know, this is so funny because this could have been my mother's cleaning cupboard.
Yeah.
The whole time I was growing up, there weren't all those products. This is what we did all our windows with and newspaper.
Yeah.
Newspaper and vinegar.
Stick.
You're younger than me.
But I think we're so far removed from
it. Thank you, Marsha.
You're welcome.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So,
Marsha,
have you already, or have you thought about
things
for
I have not. Because I was thinking of trying to get something like this started there, where we actually would mix up the products.
Oh,
and then also have a portion of it talking about personal care products. And maybe sell our own, a whole different thing. But, you know, I think.
Yeah, because I make my own motion.
I know. I know.
For a reason.
Yeah, like if you don't want to.
Or I don't like it.
If you won't eat it, don't put it on your skin, right? But anyway, think about that, because I think that would be very interesting. I mean, this one is short, and then another one of
personal care.
Yeah, because this, I could short, you know, we had, I threw a lot of extra in here. Well, one, the first class could just be learning all about it, and another class could be making the products. And
yeah,
or just home care and personal care.
Sure.
Do you know,
those are can we just look this up online, or
I mean,
look at anything else on your list. I have a handout.
Okay. Do you know, is there anybody at the Cooperative Extension Service that does tree evaluation in people's yards?
Yes, Darcy Edgeberry does, and Steve Seafelt does when he has time.
So do I just call him up and?
Yeah, call call a regular 10 and on district number, and just ask for Darcy or Steve.
Darcy or Steve.
Thank you, Marsha.
Yeah.
That's really good.
Jean helping me in this way. And the two seals, the green seal and the eagle logo.
This was really good.
Hi, Sarah. You're welcome.
I think
it's nice to see you.
Nice seeing you too. We'll see you soon. The oomph to do it. But I think I will be getting some of this, and you probably can't put essential oils in this.
You know, depending on the essential oil, it's not, I don't personally think it's the best idea because this is basically cheap plastic, and some oils are really strong.
Right, mm-hmm. That's true.
And they can affect chemical and plastics.
Yeah.
You know, all that information.
Right, it's.
You don't even think about until.
No, that's.
People brought up things that was like,
oh yeah, and
yeah, it's really, it's interesting. I just don't think we're not advertised enough with this stuff as we are compared to other products.
Evaluation.
She did do so. That's awesome.
You put these out there and then you just.
that you'll get some. They always bug me at cooperative extension about getting my evals.
And the toothpaste stuff, do you stick your toothbrush in the jar, or you just sprinkle it on?
I just sprinkle it on. It's more hygienic, actually.
Okay, that's true. I guess that makes sense.
And I actually, you know what I found? I was cruising through somewhere, and it was totally out of place, and it just probably had my name on it, but it was a little round silicone bulb with like a dressing topper on it, and it was to put individual servings of dressing in, throw in your lunch bag.
Oh, uh-huh.
And it's perfect because it has just the right size hole. If the holes are too small, it's actually hard to shake it out
right
effectively. And it just has one single hole in your hole. And it squirts out enough without too much overflow.
Right.
Really well.
I haven't tried that. I have very sensitive teeth, and the toothpaste, I just can't see spinning so much on it, but if you're not allowed.
Sensitive.
Yeah. And this stuff would be just sensitive. I mean,
well, that's why my naturopath advised me to go to that, because I had lots of stuff going on, and he was trying to fix, you know, a bunch of stuff, but he highly suggested